Hello, welcome to Chungu Cha Jamii. My name is Betty Akuku. I am your host today, and I have a lovely lady in studio. Today, we are going to be talking about something that is such a great concern in our nation today, and not just in our nation, but I guess also globally. These are same challenges that we are facing today in our society. We're going to be tackling the topic incest. When you hear about incest, it may not be something new to you. You probably heard about this, but suppressed it. Today we want to uncover it, talk about it, tell you what causes this, what are the risk factors that will lead to it, the effects, the prevention, and even so how to heal people that have suffered this. Welcome, Grace. Let's talk about this.
Thank you. Please introduce yourself. Yes. Mm-hmm. I want to introduce myself. My name is Grace Kariuki. I'm a marriage and family therapist. Mm-hmm. And I love what I do, just to help families and marriages and people in general to have the kind of relationships that they desire. And so I'm very glad to be here.
Wow.
Yes.
Thank you for being passionate about family.
Yes.
Chungu Cha Jamii is basically about family mm-hmm. and society.
Right.
That's what we do all the time.
Yeah.
And so I'm glad to host you and have you here with me in studio.
Thank you.
You're talking about incest today, Grace. Mm. What comes into your mind when you hear incest? Of course, I know you go like, ah, it does happen. Yes. What is that?
Right. Now, according to the definition that I have found, incest is sexual intercourse between members of the same family. Mm-hmm. And so we are talking about father and children, mother and children, as well as siblings. So brother and sister, that's very close. And then we also have cousins, uncles, and their nephews or nieces, aunties with their nephews and nieces. So anybody who's a relative who is close to you, having sexual intercourse with them, that is what we call incest.
Close relatives that are even forbidden to marry.
Yes.
That's what incest is.
Yes, definitely.
Wow.
Yeah.
It sounds really sad because I know for sure that was not God's intention.
Right.
When he made sex, you know. And so I wonder what the risk factors are when it comes to, you know, incest. What is it that would prompt and propel a person to do such a forbidden act?
Right. Now, we want to also talk about the mental health issues that surround incest. We want to talk about men and women who are grown and who perpetrate, as we call it, perpetrate towards children. That is not a normal way.
It's not normal.
Yes.
They probably must be having some mental
illness. There is definitely something that we need to look at mentally. So that is why it's important that we be aware that if somebody is doing that, then they do need to have a psychiatric evaluation, because it's not normal. Even when you have, if you have sexual urges, for instance, why are you going to somebody who is helpless? And when there are so many people who would definitely want to be engaged with you on that way.
Yeah.
When there are people who have, who do this for money. So if you have some money, you know,
go
find that. But when we perpetrate against people who are helpless,
minors.
And minors, children who don't even understand why that is happening, then there is a mental health issue that is going on. There is a psychiatric there is a psychological problem. And so we do need to understand one of the risk factors to this is people who have sexual addictions, people who have narcissistic tendencies. And when we think about, and I'm not saying, I don't want anybody to hear me saying every narcissist is a sexual perpetrator. No, that's not what I mean.
That's
I mean that people who have a need to have power, but at the same time, they also fear, they have a lot of fear, seated fear that they are not good enough. So they need to assert power. I will not come and just say to a person, hey, I'm ninaskia manyege, unaweza nisaidia, you know? But they want to come and take it away by force. So that is a problem. That is a person that that we want to be
they
very
have
careful.
Issues they need to deal with.
Yes.
Unfortunately, Grace, when people hear that they're being taken to a psychiatrist,
right,
the first thing that is bottom line to them is, I'm not mentally ill.
Yeah, of
you know,
course.
Mimi si wazimu,
yeah.
You know. So everyone thinks that for you to be mentally ill, mm-hmm. then you have gotten to the level where you are walking yes. down the streets yes. without clothes yeah. or in tattered clothes. Mm. You have lost your senses. You're not able to drive.
Right.
You don't know anything. You haven't gone to school. But mm-hmm. that is not it when it comes to mental illness.
No.
It's just doing the things that are so abnormal.
Yes.
That should not be done by normal people.
Exactly. So we are talking about societal expectations. Mm-hmm. When we are in a group of people, they are the ways that we are supposed to relate to one another.
Yes.
Now we do have in the area of mental illness and psychological illnesses mm-hmm. we do have personality disorders mm-hmm. and we do have people who we call psychopaths. Those are people who do not feel. They don't feel. They have no empathy, and empathy is being able to feel the pain of another. So they are very selfish, and they only think about what is going to please them,
what they can gain from that.
Yes.
I get from you that mental illness is such a wide thing
yes.
that you may not be able to cover now.
Right.
And I want us to just concentrate on
yes.
this incest,
mm-hmm.
you know,
mm-hmm.
and you already mentioned part of the risk factors
yes,
that you have.
Yes.
What is it that will lead, mm-hmm. you know, just a normal adult
yeah.
to come and do this, mm-hmm. to perpetrate on the minors
yes.
and do such an mm-hmm. abnormal act to them?
To them.
Knowing that, you know, this is not just rape,
yes.
but this is also my daughter.
Yes.
This is my cousin.
Right.
You know, this is my niece.
Mm.
Why would they just do this, apart from the fact that they're mentally ill and they don't check on that?
Right. So there is also, I would say that there is also the problem of self-control.
Mm-hmm.
So people who live as if they're animals, if I feel it, I do it.
Mm-hmm.
And there isn't that feeling of, is this right? What are the consequences
of it?
The
mindset level is
yeah,
so...
they are not thinking about anything else. They are flooded in their brain mm-hmm. with the need.
They think of it,
right,
they
and
do
they
it.
Want to do it.
Mm-hmm.
Now, there is also things like, now, because we talked about incest, is also about children.
Yes.
Among children.
Yes,
so
siblings.
Brother and sister, mm-hmm. they may do this. And one of the risk factors is how they are raised and what they have been modeled to see, plus what they watch. So now if a family of 3-5 are living in one room
mm-hmm.
and the only thing that separates where mom and dad sleep and their children is a curtain
mm-hmm.
or the mom and dad sleep, they have a decker and the children sleep up and the mom and dad sleep down,
oh,
then
such
whatever
cases are there
yeah
too.
whatever the arrangement of that home is,
mm-hmm.
children are exposed to sexual activity very early
mm-hmm.
and these children may normalize that.
Mm-hmm.
I mean, I remember when we used to play I don't remember what that game used to be, but
mm-hmm.
we used to play mom and dad,
yes.
where and your mommy, where
yes.
and your daddy,
mm-hmm.
and then they are, and we would do the things mom and dad do.
Exactly.
So you can imagine if these children are exposed to mom and dad having sex,
mm-hmm.
they will also do that
mm-hmm.
when they are playing house. And so it's important to also understand that couples who have single rooms, they need to be very careful when they are doing sexual activity.
Mm-hmm.
If their children don't think that the children are sleeping,
they're not so
and
naive.
Don't think that children don't understand.
Mm-hmm.
Remember, we as human beings, all animals, and we are part of the animal kingdom. We kind of like to model what we see.
Yeah.
We imitate
True.
What we see. We are creatures
mm-hmm.
of imitation.
We are social beings.
Yeah, and so monkeys see. Monkey do.
Yeah.
That is why we have peer pressure.
Mm-hmm.
Because when I go out with my friends and I see they are having fun,
mm-hmm.
even though I know it's not right for me to drink, I will drink.
Mm-hmm.
Because I can. We are, like you said, we are social beings and
yeah.
we like to share and we like to be able to interact together. So it's important for families to understand that. Another risk factor
mm-hmm.
is when you have a father who likes to go to the daughter's rooms at night.
Mm-hmm.
You need to be very, you as the spouse
mm-hmm.
there,
mm-hmm.
you need to be able to kind of figure out what goes on.
Yeah.
In
it's not
there.
Just going to check whether the mosquitoes
right.
are on the nets
yeah.
or they're covered properly.
Right.
Uh-huh.
So be a bit anxious.
Mm-hmm.
Anxiety is good. paranoia, a little bit of it is good.
Don't you think that is because of distrust?
Well, a little distrust is good mm-hmm. because it's going to cause you to figure, to think.
To find out
so
something.
When you have that, all of us, whenever something comes out and it's bad, we all say, I had a gut feeling.
I know.
Ni kuna kitu nilisikia. Mm-hmm. So it's okay for us to explore what is this thing. Now, and so if you are thinking, my husband wakes up around this time every mm-hmm. night mm-hmm. and I know he purports to go to the toilet.
Mm-hmm.
But, you know, nasikianga kuna mlango ingine inafungukanga mm-hmm. in a funny way.
Mm-hmm.
Now, what happens if you suspect something like that? Of course, you will tell yourself, it's just my thoughts.
Yeah.
And but it is good if you see that consistency and you are feeling uncomfortable,
mm-hmm.
it's okay to be able to wake up and kind of...
Grace, do you think such kind of a husband
yeah.
is also mentally ill? Because mm-hmm. he has that right.
Yes.
And his wife is just here.
Yes.
Why step out uh-huh. to his daughter's room
right.
and leave the wife
yes.
where he has is certified
yes.
to do it?
Yes.
Yes. Is that
now,
also mentally illness?
I want to call it, I don't want to call it mental illness
mm-hmm.
because it may not... Mental illness is not just one thing. It's a combination of many things. But I certainly want to say that is a person who is psychologically not okay. That is a person who is emotionally not right.
Mm-hmm.
Because when you move from your wife and na unatamani watoto wako or even your niece, your brother's or your sister's kid who is mm-hmm. living with you,
yeah.
then there is something that is not right with you. Let me say this. People who perpetrate towards the other people who are close relatives
mm-hmm.
and you want to have sex with them. Number one, there is a problem with your respect for the woman or even for the son if mm-hmm. if it is a young man. Number two, you have a problem of self-worth. So there is an underlying issue of your confidence that you can actually have this sexual fulfillment with people who are consenting
mm-hmm.
and who are appropriate. You see?
Yeah.
And then number three, you need to look at your sexual, whether this is about a sexual desire that you have very high libido
mm-hmm.
and your wife is not able to match up
mm-hmm.
to your libido
yeah.
or you have a problem with intimacy.
Mm-hmm.
The problem of intimacy is when you cannot connect with people in a vulnerable way because you are ashamed of yourself.
Mm-hmm.
You don't think you are worthy. You don't think you are good enough.
Yes.
You think that you are not. So you perpetrate because you have these sexual needs.
Mm-hmm.
You go to a person who is less demanding or less expecting.
Mm-hmm.
You see,
and
now a child,
no
yeah,
mm-hmm.
because a child, you see, if you are having sex with your wife, she is an adult and you are an adult and you have to walk together. So she has expectations and you have expectations. But when you go to a child, that child has no expectation. So you just go and do your thing. You see,
yeah.
there is
to
no questioning.
Up yourself.
Yeah, and let me say this. This is another risk factor that people need to be very careful about.
Mm-hmm.
People who watch pornography, that is another problem. Because you see, these are images in the mind, and we know our mind is where the information comes through. So it triggers our body to feel certain things and to want certain things.
Mm-hmm.
So whatever it is that you are feeding your mind is going to affect you. Now, every one of us, I remember have met some young men who, when they were young, they used to run around and have sex with everybody and watch pornography and all that.
Mm-hmm.
And today, when they have become grown people and they have changed, they have realized that what I used to feed my mind is what used to trigger the way that I was. And now that I'm grown
mm-hmm.
and I need to have control over what I do,
mm-hmm.
they will tell you, me, I don't watch these Alejandro things that mm-hmm. people watch. I don't
mm-hmm.
watch movies that have sexual content in
mm-hmm.
them. Why? Because they are trying to protect their mind, because that is what happens. So another risk factor
mm-hmm.
is people who are addicted to porn, because some of the porn people watch, is also children. Now, let me just say here, if there is a person who enjoys watching porn where children are having sex with adults, definitely psychopath. That is a person who is mentally sick. Even if they are doing very well, kuna shida, because that is not normal. How would you enjoy watching a grown person with having sex with a child? And so what is going to happen, even you, if that is something you enjoy, someday you are going to try to actualize it.
Let's look at our society, even our nation. There are communities that, you know, endorse such kind of a behavior.
Right.
And they have nothing, they don't feel anything evil with it.
Yes.
In fact, when they find out, they don't voice it.
Right.
You know?
Yes.
What do you think about such kinds of communities?
Well, we know historically, way back, they used to do that to preserve the purity of the lineage. So so when people want to preserve the dynasties long time ago, they used to do that where where people marry within the family.
And you don't bring a foreign blood
in here. And so to keep the blood pure, especially where you had these dynasties, kings and kingdoms and all that.
True.
So we do know that historically people have done that, but we also do know that that legally it is not acceptable. There are laws against that. And also, morally, it is not acceptable. Societally, it is not acceptable. However, what you say, there are places where it has become, I don't know whether it's acceptable or whether they have normalized because they don't want to expose.
They are probably normalized and others have even accepted.
Yes.
Because of the same dynasty you're talking about, you know, they want to carry on, you know, the people who don't live culture.
Right.
And this is very important to them.
Yes.
For their own reasons, they still do this.
Yes.
Even though, like you say, the law has not allowed it, they still do it.
They still do it,
you know. Yeah. For their own reasons, they still do it.
Right.
And they have no issues at all when people mention
such.
Much as it looks so abnormal, and sounds so weird, they still do that.
Right. You know? Now, we do have that those kinds of communities, and I don't want to comment too much on that. What I can comment on is when psychologically and emotionally people accept it because they are afraid of exposing it.
Yes.
Because there is a threat right there.
Yes, yes.
So that now, if it is within the family, for instance, there is a married couple, and she finds out that her husband is perpetrating towards their daughters. Now, perpetrating sexual violence or sexual inappropriateness towards children is not only touching them, it's also exposing them to pornography. I've had stories where children, fathers will be watching pornography and invite the children to watch with them. So that is a problem.
That's really serious.
Yeah, that is also can be within that realm of you are normalizing this behavior for the children. So that now even if you went after them, so my question is usually this: what is your purpose? Are you grooming them for something?
Of course, you're not able to control your desire and stuff, so this becomes your partner for this kind of a thing. And I can actually tell that their psychological and emotional effects are really, really poor.
They need
some kind of help to get out of this,
right.
And they're not okay at all.
Yes.
It may not just be mental illness, it may not just be psychological imbalance, it may not just be, you know, improper behavior, but I guess something.
Yeah,
when you do your diagnosis as a psychologist, you're probably able to find out what combination it is, you know.
Yes.
But let's look at this woman who allows her daughter, you know, to continue in this kind of a practice with her father, who doubles in as her husband, you know. And she probably doesn't want to talk about it for fear of stigma.
Of course.
And so she normalizes it, suppresses it. And for me, in my opinion, if you suppress this, it can only turn into depression and nothing else.
Exactly.
Because you actually know it's not the right thing to do, but you are quiet and silent because of the fear of the results when you actually vocalize it.
Yes, mm-hmm. definitely. Mm-hmm. Now, one of the symptoms of depression is helplessness. And that is what will happen to a woman whose husband is perpetrating towards her daughters.
Exactly.
So that feeling of helplessness. And I will say that a percentage of the women who will allow this to happen, mm-hmm. they themselves went through the same experience.
Oh,
so
really?
Somehow mm-hmm. their brain does not react to it because it is normal, quote unquote. Because mm-hmm. they went through it, they have never found somewhere safe to mm-hmm. talk about it. Mm-hmm. And so when it happens, they don't even know where to start. Same scenario for a different kind of person would be they shush the child and they say, do not ever say that again. Or they blame the child and they say, if it wasn't for the fact that you dress like this mm-hmm. in the house, if it was, where when do you unamfanya kuwe hivyo?
You go shower and you don't close your bathroom.
Exactly.
Your dressing is not appropriate.
Exactly. So now what happens? Mm-hmm. The child who is the victim is made to be the villain. And so now I want to also say that mm-hmm. this woman is mm-hmm. also a victim. Because, number one, this is her husband. Mm-hmm. And now her daughter is telling her, daddy ananiguza vibaya or mm-hmm. daddy had sex with me.
Yeah.
She is paralyzed. She is helpless. And that kind of a woman, I would plead with her.
Mm-hmm.
Because it is true. You are in shock. You don't know what to do.
You're helpless.
You are helpless. You are mm-hmm. going through denial. You are going through all of that.
Mm-hmm.
Please reach out to someone. And even look for a counselor, because as counselors, we have a code of conduct, which is part of it is confidentiality.
Mm-hmm.
And so you can come to someone like myself, and you can come and say, I have a very sensitive matter that I need to talk about. Now, the thing that we want to also say, that even though we are going to be confidential,
mm-hmm.
we are also mandated to protect the helpless. So that now, in fact, when I went to school in the U.S. and I practiced there for a while,
mm-hmm.
one of the things we were required to do,
mm-hmm.
if a 35-year-old woman came to you and told you when I was 6, there was a neighbor who molested me,
mm-hmm.
you had to report.
Oh, really? That was in
that
the U.S.?
Is, yes, we had to report. Now, they uh-huh. were going to follow it up. If that man was still
alive,
that individual was still there and alive,
mm-hmm.
they would go to him and he would have to be arrested.
Very most interesting.
And you
I
know
wonder
why.
What happens in Kenya.
Yeah.
But just there, let's take a break. Viewer, we are talking about incest and Grace is saying it really well. What is exactly your problem when you are the one perpetrating on the minors and doing this abnormal act with the ones that you shunned? We are coming back just now. Our SMS line is 21144. Stay tuned. Hello, viewer. Welcome to
Chungu Jajami.
My name is Tegus Tailu.
Hello, I'm Dr. Ruben West.
I'm Dr. Charles Mukuka.
From the United States of America.
I come from Ethiopia.
From Zambia.
I love Kenya very much.
I love the Kenyan people.
Love is not by confession. Love is by action.
Come on now.
When you are a husband, you are not a hushband.
It's very important.
You can count the seeds in an apple, but you can never count the number of apples in a seed.
Her phone is her phone. My phone is my phone.
You only know what you know.
Who forced you?
The more you spend time together, the more strong you
are. A woman is like a Bible.
Could tell me that they were born and it wasn't from a female,
mm-hmm.
I'd like to know.
A woman, she's a good asset.
Mm-hmm.
And a woman, she's a very, very good investment.
When you're up, your family knows who you are. But when you're down, you'll figure out who your family is.
Thank you so much. Hello, viewer.
The woman is burdened so much, such that they don't have time for themselves.
If you don't go after what you want, there's going to be hurt, there's going to be disappointment, there's going to be regret, there's going to be let down.
I love people.
People will always have a view.
They will always have an opinion.
Whether you like it or not.
It's always there.
People will put you in a shame box.
You have to love yourself first.
I'm not that person.
It should come from deep conviction. And I'm talking about conviction. I'm not talking about emotional giving.
Then that should pose a big problem.
A man who won't handle that, they will just run. Families break. Marriages don't exist anymore.
There's so many people out there pretending like they don't have the problem. Mm. Pretending like their relationship is not on the rock.
What was that?
That's nonsense.
Get lost. No. I think that is wrong.
Go ahead, tell me. I'm waiting.
Who questions you?
I'm moving on swiftly.
Moving on swiftly. On. Right.
It's pleasurable. Yeah, no one gets there without trials.
Yeah, you've got to.
It's the way life is.
Your greatest ability is possibility.
Everywhere, GBS.
Welcome back. We are carrying on with incest, and I'm here with Grace. Mm-hmm. Grace, look at the children that have been abused mm-hmm. by their fathers mm-hmm. or their uncles mm-hmm. or even their older cousins. Mm-hmm. What do you think goes on in their mind once they realize that this is what happened to me?
Yeah. Mm-hmm. Now, obviously, immediately, depression. You know, symptoms.
Even for the little girls.
Yes. Once, because the one question that you ask yourself, mm-hmm. why did he do that to me? You see, that question, why did you do it to me, mm-hmm. is actually a question that says that I'm looking at myself and I'm saying something is wrong with me. Mm-hmm. How could the person who is supposed to protect me actually
be the one to abuse me.
To abuse me. Mm-hmm. So that means there is something really wrong with me. Yeah. And once we get into that, because now the people who are coming to us as counselors looking for help mm-hmm. with maybe they come in because of stress, they come in because of whatever it is that mm-hmm. they are going through. Mm-hmm. Normally, if you do the history and you find out that there was a molestation that happened when they were younger, then that is the question they have always asked themselves. And for me, I usually want to turn that question around and say, let's ask, what was wrong with him? Because you were the victim, mm-hmm. there is nothing wrong you did.
There was probably no consent.
Yeah, mm-hmm. there is nothing wrong you did mm-hmm. to make him come after you. So the problem is not with the victim, the problem is with the perpetrator. Now, this is the thing, you are walking down the road and a stranger, you know, comes and rapes you. What did you do? Again, we all ask the same question, mm-hmm. why me? So this question of why me is what triggers the feelings of depression, mm-hmm. the feelings of self-hatred, the feelings of self-doubt. So over time, what happens is that this person is not able to really see their worth. Because it was taken away. The innocence,
their self-esteem goes down, their innocence.
Yes.
And they feel they're so really good for nothing.
Right.
And do they move on and have relationships later in life?
Oh, yeah.
They do.
Now, this is how it looks. Mm-hmm. They go on. Because they are humans,
yeah.
and we all need to connect,
yes.
and we all need the desire. We have the desires that we have that God created us mm-hmm. with. It is not good for man to be alone.
Yes.
And so we all want to be in community. We all want to be in intimate relationships. Mm-hmm. And especially people who have been emotionally abused. And when I say emotional abuse, I'm talking about where you have been made to feel that you are not good enough. You have not been given value by the people who matter. And so it can be in form of verbal abuse, it can be in form of physical abuse and sexual abuse, mm-hmm. all that. Mm-hmm. What happens is that even as they grow, they desire to connect on a deeper level. Mm-hmm. Because when we connect with people, we feel safe. We True. Feel that we are people of value. So when this is taken away, now you have planted doubt in that child's mind mm-hmm. that people are not safe. Adults especially are not safe.
Yeah.
And also, now, this is the difference between men and women. Boys who are molested, and you know we don't think boys are molested, we only think of sodomy,
yeah, yeah, yeah.
you know.
Yeah.
But we don't think about the young boy who was 10 and the house girl who was 20.
Maybe 21.
Yeah. Mm-hmm. Or the cousin who was 17 and 18 and was now exploring sexually. Mm-hmm. And she goes and tells him, "Ebu toa suruali ni kuonyeshe." Mm-hmm. You see, mm-hmm. we don't think about that for boys.
Yeah.
So what happens? These boys, what happens for them is that they get addicted. They will get addicted to sexual mm-hmm. stuff,
mm-hmm.
you see, mm-hmm. and some of them, especially if it's an older woman who taught them
yeah.
how to be sexual,
mm-hmm.
some of them will end up living their lives feeling like they are not good enough, they don't perform well, and so they keep trying with a new person, they to try and feel that they are a man who can satisfy a woman. Because mm-hmm. I mean, what will a 10-year-old do for a woman who's 20? You see, so it's important for us to also understand that mm-hmm. men and women, so boys may become more sexually promiscuous,
mm-hmm.
and they may, so even when they get married, they cannot just commit to their settled. Wife. Because yeah. it's not about sex, and it's not about love. It's about themselves
yes.
trying to prove
who they are.
Yes.
And something
so
that
it's
they can
an identity.
Yeah.
It's an identity issue.
Mm-hmm.
For women, either they will shut down, they have no libido, they have no interest in sex, they will get married and have babies.
Mm-hmm.
But that's all. They are here to have babies, they are not here to enjoy mm-hmm. a fulfilling sexual.
They're not there for intimacy.
Yes, intimacy, mm-hmm. exactly. Now you got it.
Mm-hmm.
So sexual violence and incest and anything that is perpetrated towards minors,
mm-hmm.
it actually affects their ability to be intimate.
Mm-hmm.
And also now, we are looking at the people who are doing this now to children as adults.
Mm-hmm.
We want to also look and see, do they have a history of they themselves being sexually abused?
So now, they actually both need help.
Yes.
These people should all come to your clinic
yes.
for therapy.
Yes.
Before they come, Grace, mm. the man who has abused
yeah.
the small girl,
mm.
probably they have, you know, nothing to lose.
Yes.
They already know themselves.
Yeah.
They already know what they want to achieve.
Mm.
And this is the path they have chosen
mm.
or they have found themselves in. This little girl, or even the little boy, you have told us what is going to happen to
mm.
the little boy growing up.
Mm.
But I'm concerned about the little girl
mm.
because I guess they're more abused
yes.
than the boys.
Yeah.
This little girl, once she has gone through this,
mm.
you have mentioned that it's still possible for them to relate
mm.
and have families
yes.
and have children, but
mm.
they may never enjoy intimacy
mm.
and they may never just be happy in that
yes.
kind of a life,
mm.
you know.
Mm.
Sometimes you get a child out of this
mm.
practice
oh, yeah.
of
mm.
incest,
mm.
you know.
Mm.
What do you do mm. moving forward?
Yeah.
What do you tell this child?
Mm.
How do you treat
right.
this child?
Mm.
I know of many stories in the Bible where people got children they did not want
yeah.
or out of, you know, harsh
mm.
circumstances
mm.
and they named them
yeah.
the negative names.
Mm.
You
mm.
know, what would you advise
mm.
this girl
mm.
who has gotten pregnant as a result of incest?
Right. Now what, that's a very, it's a very, very difficult process to go through. So there will be those who will decide that I can't live with this
mm-hmm.
and I'm going to end this pregnancy.
Terminate the pregnancy.
So there are those who do that. When we do that, then we have to deal with the post-abortion syndrome
mm-hmm.
and how you will live with that.
Mm-hmm.
But in addition to the now the violence or
mm-hmm.
the perpetration that you went through.
Mm-hmm.
So it's a very difficult situation. There isn't anything that is easy to tell this person. What we want to do, we walk with that person and we say, let us look at your options and let us look at what you want to do and let's support you, because none of the options you have are going to be easy. So what they decide they want to do, we offer the resources and we walk with them. So for instance, I have worked in crisis pregnancies
mm-hmm.
and somebody comes and tells me
mm-hmm.
that I want to have an abortion, and I will talk through that. I will talk through the effects of the aftermath.
Yeah.
And then I will talk also about, if you choose to keep the baby, these are the options you have. You can give it up for adoption. And if you give it up for adoption, these are the consequences of this is how you emotionally you will deal with that.
Mm-hmm.
If you decide to keep the baby and raise the baby, this is what you have to deal with. So
mm-hmm.
we look at coping mechanisms, how
yeah.
you are going to cope with each of this.
Mm-hmm.
If that person goes and has an abortion and they and they feel they now are processing and having to deal with the aftermath of that. They come back to me. I'm not going to sit there and judge them. I'm going to hold their hand and I'm going to walk through with them, because it's an emotional experience, and emotions over time, they do become normal. The intensity of it, as you have the right support, you're going to be okay. Yeah, so it's not an easy thing. Tell that child? I have no idea what you tell a child.
Who is your father?
This is your sister and your child. Yes. You know, so it is a very complicated situation. Mm-hmm. And so you want to deal with that, on a case-by-case basis, so that you work with that person mm-hmm. and help them. But generally, as a support system mm-hmm. from a psychosocial point of view, is that I'm going to be working with that person and to help them through the journey. It's not easy at all.
I get it. It cannot be easy, because you don't even know what to tell them.
Yeah.
In our 6 minutes or less remaining, yes. Grace, mm-hmm. let's look at the effects. As you have already mentioned, yes. one is, you know, there could be pregnancy yes. out of this.
Right.
What are some of the other effects mm-hmm. that incest will present
right.
before we look at how to prevent it from mm. happening to us?
Now, depression is one of them, mm-hmm. and the other one is anxiety. Depression and anxiety kind of go together. Depression is a negative view of self, negative mm-hmm. view of others, and mm-hmm. negative view of the world. So you just feel like helpless, hopeless. You kind of have those cycles mm-hmm. where you are triggered to feel those emotions.
Yeah.
When we are talking about anxiety, is the fear of the unknown and the feeling of loss of control. So first of all, I cannot trust anybody, because now my innocence has been taken away. There is no, if the people who are supposed to protect me cannot protect me, how can I trust the world out there? No. So I walk around feeling very unsafe, and so you will find people who are, I get you because before you get me, so you find people who are very aggressive.
And they suffer a lot of trauma.
Yes. Mm-hmm. And then also you do have people who are passive. They become very passive. They are not living. They are just surviving. And you find that now there is no vitality in mm-hmm. their lives. Mm-hmm. So those are some of the psychological effects of incest. Not to mention also the loss of relationships. Because you cannot have healthy relationships with these people.
Mm-hmm.
And I also want to say in a marriage, then they have a lot of challenges with yeah. intimacy, mm-hmm. with trust, and they have a lot of challenges even with, like you asked me earlier, the mother who now has daughters, she will protect fiercely her daughters even from the husband. She's the one, when the husband wakes up, she wakes up.
Yes.
You know, where are you
going? Because of the experience that she has.
Because of that. And that marriage may not last very long if the husband does not understand why the wife is acting like that. So where you have parents who will not, and I'm saying this not to say that you should allow yourself to go for sleepovers, but then you have parents who become very, very sensitive about allowing their children
to go for sleepovers
mm-hmm. where they cannot protect their children. Yeah. So this mother who is that protective, she also needs to be able to be helped to so that she can have a normal interaction with her children.
And rest yes. when she has her children or when she yes. doesn't have them.
Yes.
Prevention.
Now, prevention.
Mm-hmm. Of course, for the one with the, in a one room, you don't yes, tell them
that
to.
One. That mm-hmm. one. That one. What they want to do, what are husbands and wives who have a situation like that, you know, talk honestly. Yeah. Mm. Talk honestly and find ways that you can still be intimate with each other, but not in the presence of your children.
Exactly. You don't have to move your house.
Right.
You just plan your
yeah,
time
yeah yes. and do it in a different way. Mm-hmm. I want to say, if there is anybody who is listening to us and you find yourself attracted to children mm-hmm. and you are a man sexually attracted to children or mm-hmm. sexual or you are a woman sexually attracted to young boys mm-hmm. that you do need to get some help. That is not normal, but it is curable.
Mm-hmm.
It is something that you can talk through so that we can help you to learn how to manage the thoughts that go on in your brain. Mm-hmm. And please, again, in the homes, let's keep our homes safe. Don't allow your children to watch pornography at mm-hmm. home, to watch sexually explicit programs. Mm-hmm. And also, look at the cartoons your children are watching. Please do not just let the children just watch things with
and say phones. It's cartoons.
Phones. phones. When I get home, the first thing my children want is my phone. Mm-hmm. So you can imagine if I watch pornography on my phone, my children are going to see, don't export. So yeah. Let's prevent by making sure that we are covering our children. Number two, mm-hmm. when your child comes and says that there is something inappropriate that has happened,
yes.
Please take it seriously. Please let them tell you exactly what happened. Mm-hmm. And please, if you cannot confront the perpetrator, mm-hmm. seek our help immediately. We will guide you.
Don't blame the child
mm-hmm. and don't tell them not to tell anybody,
and don't defend your spouse.
Please bring that child even for counseling if you can, because most, like I said, you are also a victim, mm-hmm. at that point
you
are
triggered, also need help,
and you also need help. So call us, the professionals. We will be able to help you to learn how to go through this. Now this is the thing that I want to say, that you need to protect your children from the grown person who is perpetrating against your girls, mm-hmm. or against your boys. Mm-hmm. They need to leave your home. Mm-hmm. You need to protect those children.
They should exit
because
immediately.
If we do not do that, mm-hmm. we will mold the next generation of perpetrators, because we do know, it's documented, that people who have been molested, some of them, not everyone, mm-hmm. but some of them can end up molesting others. So it's important for us to do that.
The last thing that I would like you to address to our viewer.
Mm.
People say for you to heal,
yes.
then you have to talk and yes. talk it out and not suppress it.
Yes.
This is such a difficult thing,
yes.
to just sit and tell people, by the way, my dad molested me when I was 10.
Yes.
You don't do this on a microphone.
No.
You need such a safe space,
yes.
to do this.
Yes.
Do we have such safe space?
Yes.
What do I need? Mm. What guts do I need to just walk out and say, you know what?
Uh-huh.
I did it with yes. my father. I did it with my brother.
Yes.
Yes.
Now, what you want to do is find a professional counselor. Because as professional counselors, we are trained on how to deal with trauma. And I need to say very quickly that it's a traumatic experience. And trauma is when you are exposed or you experience a very fearful experience, mm-hmm. that makes you feel unsafe. Extremely unsafe, and that is what we call trauma. So there are those of us who have been trained, and so if you need that help, please find us, find a counselor. But before you open up to them, you do need to find out whether they are fully trained, whether they are accredited with Kenya Psychological and Counseling Association.
Lest they just listen to you and leave you there, yes. and not give you any help.
You want to talk with a person who is trained to deal with trauma, and they are there. We know people. There are a lot of trainings that you will see around about dealing with trauma.
Mm-hmm.
So. And also, you want to ask the person who you have called, ask them, have you ever dealt with trauma? If they haven't, look for somebody who actually understands how to deal with trauma.
I hope that there is hope at the end
of
the counseling.
Yes.
And there is a solution.
Yes.
And there is complete healing.
Right.
I would like you to give your parting shot to a viewer who has enjoyed this show today.
All right. So, viewer, I want to kind of say that for anybody who's listening to us, and you probably have listened to this and you have said, this happened to me, is there hope for me? Yes, there is hope for you. There is what we call PTSD counseling, which is trauma counseling, and you can be able to heal through a process of acceptance, a process of where your counselor walks with you, so that you can be able to go to the other side where you feel you are no longer unsafe, because now you are safe, because you are not in the same situation. And that is what trauma does. It causes us to travel back to where we call that flashbacks, and you feel as unsafe
as
when you did, mm-hmm. but this situation right now is not different. Unsafe really.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm. It's just that it triggers the same emotions you had. So I want, can I share my number? If anybody would like to reach out to me, 0707 5848 830-0707-584830. And you can find me also on Facebook, Grace Karaoke Middle-Nderito. And you can WhatsApp me. I'll be glad to. If I can't help, I have counselor friends who can. But most likely
group.
I will.
Wow.
Yes.
Thank you. Thank mm-hmm. you so much, Grace. That has been awesome.
Yes.
And I truly hope
yes.
someone else couldn't help.
Amen.
Trust me.
Thank you.
Thank you, viewer, for watching. I know you watched something so crude today, incest. But this is something we have ignored, suppressed, and covered. Today we unveiled it, and I hope you're able to find where you are, who are your people around that maybe have traumatized you without knowing. Mothers, don't condemn your daughters. Be the support system for them. Thank you. It has been such a lovely time. See you next time. My name is Betty Akuku.
Hello, viewer. Welcome to
Chungu Jajami.
My name is.